We left Gitarama, crossed into Gisenyi, which is where my father came from. My name, and this is the history of Rwandans, people could tell who is, certain names were affiliated to some ethnic groups. So my first name, Rugasaguhunga, is rather a typical Tutsi name, they say. It's a warrior name. It means who doesn't flee. So when time came for us to cross into Gisenyi, for me, I was 14, and I actually looked younger. It wasn't an issue. But for my sister, who was 16, and who at every roadblock had to provide an identification card, she couldn't go with Rugasaguhunga. So they had to kind of like bribe someone to get fake papers. And we did. So when we crossed, and we crossed into Kibuye, the French soldiers had already arrived, and the zone turquoise. For us, we thought the French were there to actually save Tutsi. We had no chance to stay behind and join the RPA camp. So when we passed by a French battalion's car, my sister said, let's run to French, and we did. So we ran quickly, you know, everything, every decision had to be. So we ran away from this Hutu family, the militia guy that we had been living with. We ran to a French soldier that was standing in front of, I think there were like two or three. In the little French we spoke, we explained the situation, and my sister said that, you know, we're moving with not only militias, but... And I just remember this French soldier. He was like a wall. We were talking to ourselves. And I didn't do much of the talking. My sister did, and said nothing. We have just put ourselves in danger by even getting closer to these French people. What are the people that we had convinced that we were one of those gonna think of us? How about these other refugees? It didn't matter to him. We had to sneak back in, and luckily the people didn't notice that we had attempted to escape.
So, Yvette, if I may, mm-hmm. can you, I think, Carl had to be,
yes.
So I wanted to just pause for a second. You have to catch a plane. Carl, did you leave? Yeah, I think you did. So can we advance, if you would? I know you're almost there.
Yes.
And I know Vincent's upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
So can you advance to... a moment when you finally your last chapter,
mm-hmm.
You know, before you were liberated,
mm-hmm.
get to that point.
Yeah,
and then I want to go back and ask you a couple of things.
Mm-hmm. So the disappointment of that moment doubled the belief that actually in the entire world, the RPA. The RPF is the only group that actually could save us. We knew with these killers, as much as we could see, we could live, we knew the minute they find out who we truly were, we would be killed right there on the spot. So we marched all the way to close to the border, the Rwandan-Congolese border, into Bukavu. But we knew crossing into Congo would mean death, immediate death. Death from the killers, death from all kind of diseases. But we had understood by then that the French were not there for us. Because after that incident, we actually tried. We were hearing about different camps. There was a school not far away down in Kyangugu that we were told a group of Tutsi students were protected. We tried to find a way to get ourselves there. We happened to, as my sister, meet someone who knew the same auntie I mentioned earlier, saw my sister on the street, just like that. Mignon, José, are you alive? This lady managed to plan and come to take us from this group of militias. Initially, she thought we could manipulate them, but these people, family said, they are going nowhere. So the good news is that in that particular time, with the pressure of the international community, the French had managed to impose the killers to no longer kill openly. So the killings were still happening, but not in a broad daylight, not on the street, and particularly where we were in this camp. So when this woman came to take us, and the killers who had been pretending that we're relatives tried to block us, we had to denounce them and say, we don't even know you. And in that chaotic environment with other refugees saying, how can you protect the Tutsi? We knew they were Tutsi. That's how we escaped. We were taken deep into the village in Kyangugu, the province bordering Congo. And really that's how we managed to escape from going into Congo. And we lived with them. They took us out of love. They really looked after us. This is a family, Hutu family, that took us in. And they made an attempt a couple of months down the road to actually go back to Kigali looking for if any family members might have survived. At this particular time, the RPF had liberated Kigali and Butare on July 4th. But we were still a distance away from the RPF-controlled area until, you know, I don't have the knowledge of the dates, but I think it might have been maybe in August, if not September, that the RPF came to that specific region. At that particular time, the French had already left. The RPA had the control of almost the whole country. And I remember when my sister and I ran that there are some RPF soldiers coming to town. We ran from that family without saying anything, and we just went. For me, we talk about the RPA. We started in 1990 believing that these people are not human beings like us, to 1994, in a sense that in every negative way, to 1994, where I actually thought they were supernatural, super powerful human beings. So I was probably disappointed to see that they are people with one head and two arms and two legs. Because for me, they had to be some superhero creatures. But also because we had been disappointed in the past by so many people, we didn't have the courage to get closer to them and identify ourselves and say, ask for help. I remember just observing them as if I'm looking at God. But also knowing that I can't get closer. They didn't say much. You know, they came, they met whoever they met, they said whatever. I don't remember what they said. I just remember that feeling of, oh my gosh, the war is actually over.